morning. Welcome to St. Andrew's. For all those who could gather with us today, and for all those that are watching online, we welcome you and hope that the Spirit moves us in the way we should today. We only have really one announcement other than what has been shown on the screen. There's a picture out in the hallway on the bulletin board of Jasper and Warren with a little update on them and how they're doing and things like that. They're the grandchildren of Kenny and Melanie. I don't know why I wanted to say that. So they're the ones we've been praying about. So there's a nice little update and some pictures of them out there. So if you want to stop by on your way out, they're there. Is there any other announcements from anyone? All right, then we will start the service with the prelude.
Thank you. belongs to God,
the earth and all its people.
It is good to live in community,
to work and talk with each other.
Love and faith come together.
Justice and peace join hands.
If the friends of Jesus keep silent,
the friends we shall die.
We are glad to be in God's house,
to listen and sing and pray.
You may be seated.
These two. Did well, Paula. You did well. Did well, my sister. Love you. Did well.
It's time now for joys and concerns. Before I open it up, I just my brother that I brought up last week that has had his cancer actually come back and has gotten worse. Last night I got a call that he was in a lot of pain, so his wife took him to the local hospital, and they decided to transfer him over to Hershey Medical Center. So I don't know, I haven't heard anything since how he's doing, but please keep Bob in your prayers and his wife Mary. They need it. Are there other joys and concerns? Yes.
A co-worker of David's was involved in a bad car accident Friday night. Person ran a red light and hit their car. Their 6-year-old son was flown to the middle of Fairfax and was fighting for his life. So the little boy's name is Paul. So please pray for Paul and all of his family.
Yes. Another beautiful day that you've given to us, another day that we can enjoy each other's company, that we can enjoy time outside, that we can enjoy just all that you have given to us, Lord. We just thank you for that. And we thank you, Lord, for all of the first responders and the military who are working through all sorts of issues in the world today, whether they're of natural origin, such as hurricane, or whether they're man-made. Lord, without them, we would totally be lost. And so we just thank you, Lord, that you you provide people that are willing to give up and sacrifice for all of our safeties. And we just ask, Lord, that you be with them all and keep them Keep them safe, Lord, so that they can come home and be with their families as well. Lord, we just ask that you be with those who are in the hospital, whether they're undergoing surgery or testing or trying to find out what is going on. Lord, just be with the doctors and nurses. Surround the families with your love and your goodness. Lord, you are the true healer, and we know that nothing is impossible for you. So, Lord, we just bring these people before you and just ask that you be with them, heal them, and just keep them strong, Lord. Keep them knowing that you are there. We thank you also, Lord, for births or coming births. We thank you, Lord, that you help to bring others into this world. And we just ask, Lord, that you be with the parents and the soon-to-be parents. Keep them healthy and safe and strong in your love. We ask all these things, Lord, through your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, Lord,
lesson this morning is taken from the book of Jonah. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "It is right for you to be angry." And then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah, so that he was faint, and asked that he might die. He said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor, and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night, and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons, who do not know their right hand from their left hand, and many animals?"
And now we will meditate on the hymn.
Thank you.
gospel lesson this morning is from the book of Matthew. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usually daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought that they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Carol. You know, when I was in the Air Force, I got a basic training, and I went to my first base with no stripes, an E1, the lowest thing you can be in the military. I worked for about a year and a half, and during that time, progressed steadily to when I actually had 2 stripes, an E3. Better pay, a little bit better working conditions, because you know how it is, and the ones that are lowest always get the worst posts. But we started seeing guys coming straight out of basic training who had volunteered for the security police, just like us. And they had volunteered for a 6-year enlistment, and they came out with 2 stripes. We're going like, "Well, that's not fair. We had to work for a year and a half to get those stripes and that pay. You're giving it to them just because they volunteered for the same thing we did. What's up?" We thought, that's just unfair. Of course, we didn't grumble to the military like the workers in the vineyard did to the landowner, because that would have been a bad thing. But the same thing happens in our reading today, and that's what we're going to look at. Our first scripture reading was in Jonah. You remember Jonah. He was called by God to bring message to the Ninevites, but he was scared, and he argued with God. Now, God's not one to back down easily. So he kept after Jonah until finally Jonah said, "Fine, whatever." But he thought, I'll just pull kind of a fast one here. I'm going to book passage on a ship going the opposite direction. Yeah, God can't be fooled. He sees everything. So he caused a great storm so that the crew felt that the only way that they were going to be safe was to throw Jonah overboard, where he was swallowed by a great fish and deposited on the shores leading to Nineveh. Jonah finally got the message after that and went to tell the Ninevites that they were headed down the wrong path and that God was going to let neighboring nations overthrow their city within 40 days if they didn't clean up their act. They did, and God relented. And this is where we pick up our reading today in Jonah. Now, before we condemn him, let's put ourselves in his place. Imagine you're called by God to go to a foreign land, one that doesn't really even like Americans very much. I know those are few and far between. But you're to tell them that if they don't repent from what they're doing, God is going to let nearby nations overthrow them and make them slaves. Now, you really don't want to go. After all, they may want to hurt or kill you just for being an American. And then on top of that, you're supposed to deliver a message that they don't want to hear. You are not going to be a popular person. So you decide to take off in a completely different direction, figuring God will get tired of chasing you and send somebody else in your place. But no, he's right there, guiding you right back where he wants you to go. So finally, you get the message, you get the courage, and you decide to trust God and go tell the leaders what the Lord has told you. And they believe you. They turn from their wicked ways, and God decides to let them live in peace. Now, how many of us are going to think, hey, you forced me to go where I didn't want to go, made me tell them things that could have cost me my head, and now you're just going to go forgive them? I was scared out of my mind. Why did I have to go if you were going to let them live anyway? I know, that's what would have been running through my mind. Well, God tells Jonah in chapter 4 that he shouldn't be angry for him. He should not be angry at him for being merciful. But Jonah wasn't in any place to listen, so he stalked away and sat under a tree, sulking while he watched Nineveh. Well, God decided to teach him a little lesson, so he created a nice shady plant to grow over him, to shelter him from the sun. Then the next day he had a worm come and eat the plant, sent a hot wind to blow, scorching sun beat down on him, till Jonah felt he just wanted to die. This gave God the opportunity to show Jonah that even though he had nothing to do with the growth of that plant, he was unhappy that it had died. I saw this kind of the same thing in my garden this year. I had planted some collards, and leaves came up nice, and they were looking really good, and we cut some back, and Jolene cooked them up for us, and we enjoyed those. And then they keep coming back. I don't know if you've ever planted collards, but the more you cut them, the more they come back. And they came back, and you know, we were kind of tired of collards after, you know, a time or so. So I kind of didn't do a lot with them. And now bugs have come and eaten holes in them. I'm not happy about that. But do I have any right to be mad at God for it? No, I did nothing to prevent it. Right? So it's on me. In the same way that Jonah felt about the plant and I feel about my collards, God would have felt about Nineveh dying. Since he did create it, and he did let the people, and he did create the people who inhabited it. In the story of Jonah, we see Jonah who thought that only the Jewish people deserved to be forgiven and protected by God. He saw those in Nineveh as beneath God's grace. Now, don't we sometimes do that ourselves? I mean, should a serial killer like Ted Bundy, who killed 30 women, have been able to ask for and be given forgiveness and welcomed into heaven? I mean, I've tried to be fairly good all my life, but at least I haven't killed anybody. And I've tried to stay on the right path. So why should he get the same reward that I'll eventually receive when I get to heaven? simple answer for me, as it was for Jonah, is that God created everyone, even Ted Bundy, and wants all of his creatures to be with him in heaven. I believe that God sheds a tear when someone has to be condemned to hell. No person is better than any other person. Nobody is born bad or evil. They just make bad decisions along the way. When I think of forgiveness and people who are trying to follow God's plan, I think of the Amish. You may recall 2006 when a gunman went into a school in Lancaster, Pennsylvania and killed 5 young girls and shot some others. The community and the families of those impacted forgave that shooter from their hearts and prayed for the soul of that man. They had nothing to do with his birth or upbringing. They didn't even know him. But they were able to get past their grief and forgive him. Now that is what God is asking from all of us. Is it fair to us for someone to come to God in the last minute of their life and be loved and forgiven for all of his or her past life and sins so that they can get into heaven when we're trying to do our best to live a life worthy of heaven? It may not seem so to us, but it's fair to the one who counts, God. Personally, this is something that I do struggle with. Now, I can forgive others when they do something against me. But if somebody does harm to my family, close friends, or my country, I have a lot of difficulty forgiving them. In fact, I'll probably want to get revenge on them. Is this a Christian attitude? No. But it's something that I have to work through. I have to remember that I've not always been an angel, even though I used to always tell my mom, I'm a little angel. And she used to set me straight saying, you know, the devil has angels too. God has forgiven me many times. I should do the same. Also, I have to keep in mind that revenge is the Lord's, as stated in Romans 12:19, where Paul reminds the churches of Rome, as well as us, do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. Easy to read, easy to hear, difficult to take to heart, at least for me. However, in Proverbs, we're told in chapter 25, verses 21 and 22, if your enemy is hungry, give him food to eat. If he's thirsty, give him water to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head, and the Lord will remind you. For me, that's something to remember. So if I forgive somebody who wrongs me and am nice to that person, it may cause them to feel bad. Again, not exactly a Christian attitude, but it helps me get along. I've actually seen this where, you know, somebody has done wrong by me and gone out of my way to be nice to them, and they almost always turn around within a time and apologize. Yelling at people, screaming at people, that does nothing. Forgiving them and letting them know that you still love them as a person, even though you may not like what they did, that will bring you a lot more rewards here on earth as well as in heaven. We may be the first to come to God, but we should be ready to be the last to be served. And this leads us into our gospel lesson in Matthew 20. There's workers that a landowner hires to do some work in his vineyard at the start of the day. They're hired at a specific wage and knew that they'd be working all day. Later that day, the landowner goes out and hires some more workers to get the grapes all picked quicker. At the end of the day, everyone gets paid the same, and those that had been sweating all day long felt they had been cheated because the workers who had only been there half the time or even an hour got the same pay as them, just like those airmen that came out of basic. Now, an editorial, I can't blame them. If I've been doing a job all day and someone comes in halfway through and gets the same pay, I'm going to feel slighted. Well, the landowner put the workers in their place, as Jesus does to those listening to this parable and to us who read it today. That it was his money. He can do with it what he wants. So since they had already agreed to that one wage, it's none of their business if he wants to pay those that only did half the work or even an hour's work the same wage. Likewise, it's God who created the earth and everything on it, as well as in heaven. And it's up to him, not us, who gets into heaven and who gets the benefit of his grace and forgiveness. It's really none of our business. In verse 8, I was interested to read that the landowner told the foreman to pay those that had been hired last to be paid first. This made me think of the days before my time, when the military paid their personnel in cash. They usually started with the lowest private and worked their way up to the officers who got paid last. This still applies in many aspects of the military. I know when I was stationed in England, walking wingtip to wingtip in front of an airplane for 8 hours a night or 8 hours a day. Those of us on those stationary the posts, which were usually those lowest in rank and those that had come in to the military last, were relieved for chow first. The sergeants and the higher ranking airmen who were riding around in the flight line in trucks, who had been there longer than us, didn't get to go eat until all of us had been relieved first. The last were first, and the first were last. Where this comes into play in some of our lives is when we came to Christ. I know in my case, I was born into a Christian family. My dad was an Air Force chaplain, and then after he retired, became a Methodist minister. I went to Sunday school every Sunday, church every Sunday, Wednesday evening church. I was in the youth groups, attended vacation Bible school every year. As a family, we read the Bible in the upper room every night and said the Lord's Prayer before going to bed. And then we would go to bed and Mom would be there to make sure we said our individual prayers. Now at age 62, I'm now a certified lay servant. I've been one for about 8 years or so. I came to know, love, and accept Christ's grace at an early age, and it kind of coasted along ever since. On the other hand, there are people who never knew anything about Christ, never went to church, and just lived their lives like they wanted to, until God hits them with a board, and they hit rock bottom, and they're brought to Christ. They're forgiven for their past sins, and they go on to lead programs that change others' lives on a huge basis. My dad told us that actually during World War II, he was an agnostic. He didn't believe that God cared anything about anybody. He did not want anything to do with it. But Christ kept at him, pushing him to believe and to accept his forgiveness and love. And Dad went on, went to seminary after he got out of the army. Became a minister. I remember him saying his first charge, he had like 7 churches. And then he joined the Air Force and spent the rest of his life working to bring others to the love of God. The last will come first. Are we asking God to be hired into his vineyard to help bring others to him? Or are we sitting idle in our pews letting others do the work? It really doesn't matter at this point. This parable tells us that whether we're the busy bees in the church and have been since we joined, or whether we've been sitting back, kind of waiting for an invitation to join a committee or to start a mission that can help others to know the love of Jesus Christ. We're all called at some point to work for the Lord. And work doesn't have to be standing up in front, delivering sermons, or singing in the choir, or singing special music. You can get involved in smaller ways. Perhaps you're pretty computer savvy. Well, let the technology committee know. I'm sure we'd welcome you to help put those slides up on the screen for each Sunday, or learn how to use the camera system and give Stephen a break down here. Even making cookies or Easter eggs, which hopefully picks up next year. Or quilters, just bringing in, not everybody can sew, bringing in the material or cutting the material so that those that can do the sewing can do that. Even giving your tithes and offerings to the church and supporting programs, these are all ways to do the work of the church. Seek God's guidance. He will lead you to what you can and should do to help advance His kingdom. And remember that when you ask God for His help, first, you need to wait and listen to what He tells you. And then, you need to act on what He tells you. Remember what happened to Jonah when he decided not to listen to what God wanted. Don't wait to be swallowed by a large fish to go where God wants you. Amen. It is time for our offertory. We thank those that are diligently sending in their tithes and their offerings, those that are placing them in the box in the back when you come in or leave, those that are giving online. We thank you for this, to keep the church open and keep our doors open. Without you, we can't do the work of Christ.
Thank you.
this is actually taken from the Iona Book of Worship that I picked, well, I didn't pick up, I paid for it. When I was in Scotland, Iona, the church on the island of Iona, just off the coast of Scotland, is the first Christian church in Scotland. And it was really interesting. On a Sunday morning, my sister and I were there, and unfortunately there was a storm, so we couldn't stay for the service. We had to get back because the only way to get to it was on a ferry. So we had to get back or else we would have had to spend the night there. But it's a small island, and it was really interesting that almost all of the inhabitants of that island walked to that church Sunday morning to go to worship. It was amazing. It was like stepping back into the 1800s. It was amazing. So I found their book of worship and purchased a copy. And this is where the benediction as well as the call to worship came from. So let's say this together. We ask your blessing, Lord,
on our lives, our homes, our journeys, wherever we rest, wherever we travel. Bless us with love and wonder every day. Amen.
The Lord bless you, be with you through this week, and remember to bring somebody or tell somebody about our online services for next week. Go in peace. We'll release from the back.